I just wanted to spend a couple of minutes on the moment that you think the court is in now. I know you guys are sort of cloistered, but you're not cocooned. We came through this sort of acrimonious process of confirmation.
Did it relate to alcohol?
I like
you
beer.
You haven't answered that.
I like beer. I don't know if you do.
Okay.
Do you like beer, Senator, or not? What do you like to drink?
Next.
What you want to do is destroy this guy's life, hold this seat open.
How do you view it from the inside? I mean, how does the court and family, community, adjust to those moments?
I'm going to steal a line from one of my colleagues, okay. A story, actually, not a line. And it was Justice Thomas, who tells me that when he first came to the court, another justice approached him and said, "I judge you by what you do here. Welcome." Mm-hmm. And I repeated that story to Justice Kavanaugh when I first greeted him here. Now, I've known him, I've known of his work, but when you're charged with working together for most of the remainder of your life, you have to create a relationship. The nine of us are now a family, and we're a family with each of us our own burdens and our own obligations to others, but this is our work family, and it's just as important as our personal family. We probably spend more time with each other than most justices spend who have spouses with their spouses.
But beyond your personal relationships, as this moment in history, do you have concerns about how people view the court because of the partisanization of everything?
It's a concern, obviously, to the extent that we're citizens. And all of us have a passion about this country and about our Constitution and our system of government. That to all of us is critically important. I think many of us feel that what people perceive as partisanship is erroneous. There are thousands and thousands of cases that come through the federal system every day. 95% of them are resolved in the district, on the trial level, on the district court level. Only 5% of those cases are appealed. That means that the vast, vast, vast majority of people have gone through our judicial system and accepted its judgment. Of the Court of Appeals cases, and there are thousands and thousands and thousands of them, we only hear about 60 to 70 cases in recent years. And anywhere, it's been as high as 40 to 70% of the cases are decided almost unanimously. There is certainly a percentage of cases that are not. And we have our share of 5-4 decisions. But is it partisan, or is it because, as I believe, we approach judicial decision making in different ways? Judges are given a toolbox of interpretive tools, and with it we come to our conclusions. If you build a house with one tool, it looks one way. If you pick a different tool, it looks another way.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what happens. And so that the political parties have aligned themselves with certain of our judicial approaches, we can't control. And I'm saddened that they are viewed as partisan in that way. But I don't think it's a fair judgment of what the court does every day.
But surely you know that this court is going to be, probably for the duration of your tenure on the court, a conservative court.
I don't know what that word means. Conservative, liberal, those are political terms. Do I suspect that I might be dissenting a bit more? Possibly. But I still have two relatively new colleagues, one very new colleague, Brett Kavanaugh and Neil Gorsuch. And we've agreed in quite a few cases. We've disagreed in a bunch, but, you know, let's see.
You you told a group, I think at your alma mater at Princeton in 2017, that there was a point in the process of confirmation that you questioned whether you wanted to continue because of just some of the things that the ugliness of the process. And you said, if this process is going to result in my getting this to the Supreme Court, a diminished person, is it worth it? Now, your friends talked you out of that. But it does speak to the nature of the process. It is by definition, especially in the modern era, a very rough process.
It is. It wasn't the process for most of the history of the United States. This public questioning system only started about 1960s, 1970s. Before that, there was a long period of American history where candidates, applicants, whatever word you want to use for what we
nominees,
are,
yeah.
nominees, weren't even questioned by the Senate at all. A senator would convey the president's nomination, speak on behalf of the nominee, and then opponents would say their piece and there be a vote. It's gotten more elaborate with time. Some of it is the product of television. Some of it is the product that people are asking nominees for things they can't give. You know, what's important to people is what's important to them in political campaigns. How are you gonna vote? But that's something a judge with integrity or someone who wants to be a judge with integrity would never say.
I know you're not going to comment on the specifics of the Kavanaugh hearing, but you know it became a flashpoint for this Me Too movement. And you wrote in your book about the barriers and the kind of difficulties that women faced when you were coming up as a young prosecutor, including, you know, elements of harassment. Did you face that?
I don't know that I experienced harassment in the way that people are describing. Did I have moments where a supervisor acted in ways that I wish they hadn't? Absolutely. I think it's a given, Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg has spoken about it, that big and small things happen to women all the time. The off-color jokes that really shouldn't be told do happen. The supervisor who says something that makes you feel uncomfortable, the supervisor who asks you or tells you something about their feelings about you, and you have to look at them and say, I really think you're a wonderful person, but I don't feel the same way, thank you.
Mm-hmm.